request Dr. Sundararajan to address on the topic big data in the current age. Over to you, Doctor.
Thank you, Suvini, for the nice introduction. Thanks, Prashant, for organizing. And it's wonderful to have a collaboration with Sri Lanka, which we were missing quite a long time. So I will share the screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
So I think morning also we had some talk on big data, but I just missed it to go out for my COVID vaccination. So we are getting a lot of data. So what things are happening in the current time or age? What we call big data, and how we get the big data, and do we get enough big data, or do we get more data than what we were, and are we able to understand the reality, in reality, what is the big data, and how we are going to put into use. So I collected some of the information which is going on currently. So I'll give you a walkthrough on it. So we get massive data. This is not new. All of you know that we are getting a huge amount of data in bioinformatics, not only in bioinformatics, but other domains like banking, insurance, and things. So it brings more than what we can go through data, either protein or NGS data, genomic sequences, even the COVID data or trial. A lot of trials are going on COVID. So we get a lot of data. So data is immense. And only thing we need to know what data we want to go through, what we want to find, and whether we are going to do it in a real way, it's going to be used. So the Human Genome Project is growing every year, and we are getting a lot of data. And recently, as we have seen, that data is not generated only through the machine. It's also automated process through algorithms. Many of the genome projects, they don't put strain or money in getting everything out by the sequencing process. Rather, they go in for a lot of matching and algorithm way, so that majority of the sequence are built in silico. And also parallelly, they try to whether how things are worked from the laboratory side. So sequence is growing through the laboratories, also through algorithms. On the other end, we see a lot of disease problem is happening, which we are getting even the recent COVID, which has shattered the entire world, and still we are analyzing what is things happening about it. And so a lot of genetic diseases are coming out, and we see change of pattern, and the virus get itself changed, mutated, and we are all puzzled how things are happening. So not only the data is there, the data is moderated or regenerated or changed, and still we, and on the other end, the diseases, how we are able to handle the disease. Is there a way to use methodology, big data, or algorithm, or what source to know how the disease can be controlled or predicted or understood its base? So I'm giving a general line, like we can take bioinformatics and big data. These two are go in parallel. Like bioinformatics with the basics of data analytic tools is the understanding of the huge volume of data. So some of you may be thinking that the bioinformatic tools are only useful in biology and not in other places. But I have established in my career that it can be used in even predicting dengue vector spread. We have modeled down it, and to the student, how the student want to get their own like a personalized education material, and bank wants to know things, and a lot of things are possible with the bioinformatic tools. So, but on the other side, we have a volume of data, and we have tools from bioinformatics that really give a good hand in hand to analyze a lot of things. So it can be useful for like identification and treatment of disease. Things are happening on the clinical informatics, how fast we can understand the diseases, whether we want to understand the disease only through a pathological surveys or things, or we get patient data also. The personalized data also is to be useful. All these are going in a big scale in trying to understand the basis of the disease, how it is spreading, and things like that. And because of this immense data, it reduces the cost significantly, because data is almost there. Only thing we need to pick up the right data, portion of data, and the tool to analyze it, so that we are able to get the inherents as quickly as possible. And better health is provided at an early stage. Like in the cancer case, we still a lot of algorithms are being developed to see whether we can predict it at the early stage, rather than patient goes to the advanced type 4 level, where it becomes difficult for medical science to recover the patient. Care of patient, as the data is increases, not only the base is increased, but we get more updates periodically from various sources that helps to streamline our algorithm, or we call algorithm in some set of way to predict a model. See, a particular patient is prone to cancer, or some cancerous can happen or not. So more data update are more required, so that it can be fine-tuned. And all this helps in disease control measures. Like the COVID also, we see how the disease is spreading. And if we are able to do the population disease control, that would really make the world a more better place for everyone. So when you say data and analytics, how we look at it? Data on the one side collected from DNA, such as genes or full genome, amino sequence, a protein, or you can have three-dimensional structures of protein. We get more kind of data. So the data is explosive growth from mid-90s because of the genome project and a lot of new technologies coming in, sequencing, NGS come up, and we get a lot of data. So what is the analytics on the other side? So if you put bioinformatics and computational biology and analyze the biological data, particularly DNA, RNA, and protein sequence, so we are able to model this towards some disease or function or things like that, which we are unable to find otherwise. We are very costly experimental analysis in the lab, which restricts us because of the shortage of fund and things like that, manpower. So these tools help mainly to analyze all the available sources, and we are able to predict or move along to model sort of things. Let us see how the impact of big data on bioinformatics, various subtopics we can say. In biology, we take what are the benefits of big data in biology? Because of new modern technology, from the traditional way of getting data, like long back, we used to get data in a laboratory way, which takes very long time, and like almost like to model a protein structure, it looks like one or two protein structure gives a PhD. That's what I used to see. People say, I modeled this particular protein in PhD. That's a traditional way, and it takes 3 to 5 years in getting data. But now, because of a lot of technology, like we can able to do faster scale, get either the sequence or the structure. Because of this, cost is effective. You can see we can get things done in a couple of months rather than in years. It's really time saving, and we are able to analyze it and know whether the direction we are going in is going to be fruitful in a shorter and easier way rather than waiting for a couple of years. So the big data and bioinformatics gives lot of creating lot of genomic and protein sequencing in a faster scale. And that really helps in prediction of protein structure. On the sequence side, similarly, we get a lot of genomic sequence because of big data and algorithmic effects. We are able to bring more data and also we are able to map them, identify and map human genetics, and disorders are blueprinted. So the availability of big data helps sequencing get more and more data because of the availability of tools. That also reduces a lot of cost in sequencing. And also it is proved that more errors are reduced in the analytics algorithm in sequencing rather than the sequence is being produced in laboratory. Because of some problem or sometimes the probe is not okay, but still we get the sequence, but it may not be accurate. Rather, the proven sequence data is used to regenerate more segment of sequence, which is less error. Now, the main concept everywhere going is on the healthcare. How the healthcare is what not done for a quite several decades, but now everyone has taken up and see how much. Today also, when I went for the COVID vaccination, they are collecting a lot of data. Why? They want to know how the effect of the vaccine in the next 1 year time, how it is going to be good, bad, and things like that. How, what are the effects on it, things like that. So the collection of data is very important from patient side. And patients are nowadays coming up in giving the data. Earlier, they don't used to give much data. They are feared to retrieve, give their data to people like research and all. But now it's the mindset is changing, and people know that we can give data. It's also useful for a person or for the entire community. And it is helpful to monitor the health, how the health is moving on, and also the treatment of diabetes, chronic, heart diseases, cancer condition. So the big data has a very big usage. This case, even though whether we build my sequence or whether I get my structure, but in the healthcare is more important that we can save people, and we are able to prescribe what are the things happening to set up patients because of their diseases and the condition and how they are progressing. So this has a really very big value because of big data and analytics that really now in Singapore also, most of the hospital has started being for only research. There is a team only for to collect data and analyze them and see how things can be modeled or how we are able to get inherence of any disease, things like that. So the things are changing and people are collecting more health data. And basic is bioinformatic technique. The data is mined to get an understanding what is happening on a segment of people, whether due to race or due to age or due to gender, what is happening. So they are able to correlate between all these basic human things and with the diseases and how the reports are coming up. So the ultimate aim is to get an identification on a better treatment so that people can be changed for a better treatment rather than see whether they are in the right direction or not. And of course, the cost of treatment is reduced and gives a better health, and patient care is taken care. Also, of pharmaceuticals, they are now planning for preventive or personalized medicine. Now, they also collect a lot of data, and then manufacture looking for cost-effective medicine. They collect data on genome, proteomics, metabolomics, and then they're trying to diagnose up this model for proper treatment. So the structure of disease, and they target for a potential drugs. So this, because of data, big data, and proper tools, they're able to quickly develop the target drugs more efficiently in shorter time, rather than they do it over several years of time. And this really helps in, because of silico, a lot of things have changed. And even we can see that COVID vaccine has come out very fast because of this effort in silico plus the lab development. That reduces a lot of time. And in reality, we are able to get things faster than earlier. Earlier, we used to wait until a decade to get things done through laboratory and put it into the market. But now we are able to get them faster scale. So that helps prevent diseases, disability, and death. So what tools we are trying to do? So we have the deep learning and machine learning. So a lot of talks today happened. They were talking, and Professor Jayaraman was talking about a lot of algorithm. We are not going there. I'm generally telling that all those tools are useful in big data, because when the data is big, we don't know what to do. As a human, we cannot go through millions of records and see which are the real ones I need to use it, or how to model, or as Professor mentioned, what are the factors? Like, what are the factors in my data is going to be useful that I also don't know. So all these machine learning algorithms help in getting to know what are the factors relevant for a particular disease or a particular banking scheme or particular structure prediction or sequence prediction. All, whichever topic we take, it's going to be the same basics of machine learning and algorithms. But the only thing, we need to know how to use these tools in a proper way so that we are able to understand for a particular domain where we are applying these tools more effectively and properly. And still, as I mentioned, the domain knowledge expert is important, because sometimes when I model these factors and then when we consult a doctor, doctor say, no, you're throwing away something which is going to be more useful. But as a machine learning, we thought we had that aspect. It's reducing our accuracy. But that is a very important factor. The doctors say you must add it. So probably we have some data in our data, big data, which are making bias regarding to a particular information. So that we have to identify. If we can identify that, then our model can go with a proper expert knowledge and we include what are the things we need. And we have a lot of platforms like cloud platform. More tools are coming up in Hadoop, a lot of storage is coming up, and these all help in understanding the human health and business. Any questions so far? Hello, any question?
Excellent, Dada. I think you may go ahead, please.
Okay, so let us go to the next thing. These are some of the impacts. Big data analytics are used in various machine learning. And one thing I want to mention is, what is the deep learning? Some people were talking these days. So for example, if I can model for a particular drug, I got more data. like big data gave me a lot of data, I collected it. For another type of drug, I do not get data, not much data is available. So how I can do anything on analytics? That's where the deep learning comes in idea. If I can model a particular drug with more data and is said, what are the prototypes, what are the things required, then the same thing can be applied for another drug, the knowledge gained from the drug one. That's where the deep learning helps in bridging the learned model to another where we are, it is difficult to learn the model or build a model due to the shortage of knowledge and availability of pre-known information. The deep learning is able to break that and give an idea what are the things it could give a direction. That the deep learning is coming out big way. And we believe it will have a good impact in the near future so that we are able to get more things where we have shortage of known data. So these are some of the threats I put. Okay. Now we have seen all put about the big data. We thought, big data is doing everything. So we collect. From tomorrow, we just start collecting all data, then we get everything done. It's not so easy. So even in 2021, we see still there are a lot of challenges. We will go through what are the major challenges when we are going to jump into a big data analytics or collection of data. So when we do the analytics, it may fail to provide insight. The data may not be able to converge, clear, and say what is the thing we want to model. It may not be able to get in because the data may be incomplete. As I just mentioned, some column or data we collected, maybe the person who gave the set of people who gave data, they might have not given the data correctly, or they would have omitted some of the fields, telling gender or age or education. A lot of things people don't update the data because for some reason or other, they don't give data. But when we model with all the data, it becomes a biased data. Means it cannot converge to know which sector of people or which age group of people prone to this particular vaccine or particular health problem because the data is not clear. Because everyone has not quoted their age or anything because of some reason or other. So if the data is incomplete or we have a biased data, means people give false data instead of giving, they fear to give data, so they just put some other number instead of putting a proper one. So the biased data will lead into a lot of trouble. Means we don't converge to know which set of group of people, which age group or which community or which, what is happening among them. And also sometimes getting data is a problem because we see we don't get data updates very quickly. Even though we try to get more data, but it takes very long time in getting data. And by the time the project people cannot wait and they have to end up not able to build the proper data into the requirement. So expert knowledge is not embedded into the model. Sometimes we don't get the proper knowledge person on the data so that he is not able to put his effort or knowledge that the model is not fine-tuned, then also it's a problem. So there are always some lagging is there. Not like I just collect all the data and tomorrow I get the model and it's not happening in that way. So it's a long run. Further, whatever we are trying to do with good data, sometimes the data fail to provide insight because of quality of data, system errors, because the data is so big, it crashes, and the model is not accurate, low accuracy, only 10% accuracy. Then how can we say only 10% the person is going to get this group of people going to get this disease or anything? Then it becomes difficult to convince anyone. And this model is not going to be useful unless we get at least 70 to 80% accuracy of a model that can say 70%. Even the vaccine we have seen, if it is 85%, then we say, oh, its efficacy is 85%. So today I went and took it. If it is only 10%, then I also think whether it is worth taking the vaccine or not. So anything lower accuracy, nobody is going to agree to accept it, or the model will be of no use. And also model is not consistent sometimes. Whenever I run through different algorithms, it gives different aspect. That means it's not very consistent. So we cannot say which is the factor going to be very useful in finalizing our model, so that we can say data can go predict the disease. That cannot be balanced because the model is not consistent. I mean, not consistent with what we are trying to predict. Sometimes, just I was mentioning, the analytics becomes complicated, unclear data visualization. We cannot visualize the data, what we are trying to bring out. And sometimes we see the data is short, and so model becomes biased and unable to converge to anything. So we have to revalidate the data. And after revalidation, we find the data is not complete or not enough to do anything on that scale. Also, we are unable to involve, as I mentioned, external expert to decide on data. And the expertise say that this particular experiment or column are useful, like this assays or serology test or anything, but that data is not available. So then we are unable to do anything. So the better idea is either bring external domain expert or rebuild the model with subdata. We have to see whether whatever we collected data, some portion of data with the knowledge of expert, can we build something so that initially we are unable to get the things at the proper scale, can be done. This is what I was mentioning, that a lot of time using a huge data, the system crashes. And many people say, oh, my computer is enough, not enough to compute this data because the genome is so big, I cannot do anything. So how I'm going to solve the system problem? And then time delay in getting the knowledge because system cannot run. And then how we are going to bring it into the way that we are able to use it? Volume of data is becoming very big, and we are unable to order them in a proper scale, and the system is unable to take in all the data we want to analyze. Either I'm not getting the data, after getting it, I cannot process it. Because of the huge scale, the computer system is not enough to organize it or run it, things like that. So we have to make a proper resource utilization. It's not that I get all data, but we have to pre-plan how we are going to use the which portion of data and then process it step by step. What I recommend is take a sub-data and then upscale our idea. Take expert knowledge so that they will give, maybe this set of data is more useful. So you concentrate on this, say pathological test or clinical test, that is a first. Then add more sub-data step by step, so that and see whether we are able to build, whether it is sequence or health data or disease modeling. So take portion of data and then see which has more effect building our model. Obviously, we have a big maintenance problem when we go for a very big data, huge storage requirements of data that always add into a big trouble. People buy terabytes and then say, oh, I need more place to download my genomic sequence because already it's full. Already it's full, I cannot run anything. So we are always bothered about the storage requirement and infrastructure cost. So we need to plan better hardware cost effective, or better to go for a cloud solution where you can pay as a, because nowadays cloud solution, if I take lesser data space, then I pay less. If I take more space unnecessarily, then I have to pay more. The cloud solution. Rather, I take data wherever it is required, step by step. So I don't pay unnecessary cost. I don't boggle down with buying huge requirement, and then maintenance cost is very difficult. Every year, 1 year I buy some funding, I got some funding. Next year we will pay me for maintenance. Then again, I have to write up another project and wait until I get my funding to maintain this hardware purchase previous year. So this becomes a bottleneck. So now the better thing is go for cloud solution where we use a public data, because cloud, we cannot put our own data because it's a common storage. Hackers are active 24 hours. So we don't want to lose our important data. Whatever publicly available, we can put it in cloud and we can increase the space as much as I want. When I need, I increase the temporarily the space. Even cloud solution, they give a time in off scale, right? Run it in a night, they give it as a free something island. So I run my script to run it the night so that I use a huge data in the nighttime so that I don't pay any money. And like that, we are having a lot of solutions which help us to manage our cost effectively and also get things done in a better scale. So it will be a very simple model and it can scale up step by step, and we are able to go through it in a better way. So these are the bottlenecks we have in handling the big data, but still we are able to make ourselves go through it. We have to plan things in a proper scale. That's the main thing. Before we jump on to start collecting data, we need to get expert opinion and also people who are going to help in building the model, like machine learners. Because a lot of softwares are there, like Weka is a publicly available software, W-E-K-A. We can download and build model in a simple way. But we need to understand things. What are the things we are going to do? Whether the data we are planning is enough? All this, after that, we are able to pull on the big data. Okay, I want to give some, so the big data thing, I want to just show one or two things, projects. So this was done for an antimicrobial database some time back. So even now, even though it was done about 8 years back, 8-9 years back, but still we are unable to update the data. That's a big thing because of manpower. We need some research scholars to work closely, get more data so that we can rebuild the antimicrobial peptide database. So this is where it lacks, that we need people. The data is available, but we need people to curate it, add it to the database. So this is one of the things. And we build database. Why we build databases from the big data? So that we get curated data and segment of data so that we are able to do analytics. We can do BLAST to check whether anything is antimicrobial and things like that, whether it is antifungal or antibacterial, antimicrobial. All this can be checked the sequence level once we have a curated data, the database. That gives a shorter way in getting things moving forward to get more, better, cleaner data on the scale so that the researchers can go there and check the data, whether it is correct or useful, or then they can do the proper laboratory experiment and then find out whether it is really an antimicrobial or bacterial, or what are its function, how things are happening. The database is one of the important thing, which is even though it takes a time to make it. And our recent study I want to highlight, and this one is, we are doing it with the school children, actually. Some of you may be surprised to see this database is developed by two school children who are doing class 8. Recently, we started bioinformatics for school children. And this project we are going to submit very soon. I'm also waiting for the kids to come back after their school exam sometime this week. Then we'll finalize this and submit for a good journal. This one is the SARS coronavirus, which is, we are going to, we've started, this one is already live, but not all the functionalities are there. And in this also, we have a lot of immense of data from NCPI, UniProt, and still I am waiting if some more researchers want to collaborate, then we can go further and analyze the clinical trials so that we are able to get more inference of this COVID data, how only 29,000 base pair is making a lot of trouble in everywhere, and it's also getting mutated and getting more stronger strains that is circulating everywhere. So I'm also keenly interested to analyze it more depth so that we know how these things are happening for the COVID database. Okay, now we can take some questions.
Thank you, sir. So if the audience have any questions, you can pose it in.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sundarta, we have Uttam Sharma here, our hardware manager. So he has a question, please.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is, in case of unstructured data available in my Excel sheet, which platform do you use for data analytics?
Actually, I told, right, platform is immaterial. Whether you are able to do it in your laptop or in your desktop or any big server available to you, it doesn't matter. Because most of the big data is unstructured only. Only thing you have to know, but one thing, you need to learn coding. That is the thing. When handling big data, you need to learn the coding so that you can extract what data you want from the unstructured big data. Then you can use in any platform. Even for an example, we were tracking a very huge data in our office, and whatever machine we had, we could not run the thing because it's really a million data. Every day we get 3 million data, and each record is bigger enough. It cannot be held in any computer. But I told them we cannot go upscale for machines, but easy to break it in a way that it is possible for any computer to run. I devised it in a script level and it was successful. So platform is not a big deal. Only thing, you have to apply your own idea and see how you can make it through.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
So if there are no questions, I think we should thank the speaker.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very
sir.
Much, Sundarta.
Thank you all. You can all send any doubt or anything. Anybody wants to start up a big data in Sri Lanka or anything, you can free to talk to us. We are always there. We want to encourage new budding researchers, and we want to see things are being organized and structured so that it is going to be useful to the research community.
Thank you very much, sir, for spending your time and sharing your knowledge. So we will move on to the last address for the day, which will be done by Professor Aparna Banerjee. Professor Aparna Banerjee is currently working as an assistant professor in the Catholic University of Mal in Chile. She is a PI of the project Bacterial Exopolysaccharides as Antioxidant and Emulsifying Agents. As a researcher, her areas of interest in microbiology of extremophiles, exopolysaccharides, biotechnological applications of the exopolysaccharides, and bioinformatics analysis. I would like to invite Professor Aparna to deliver her address.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction.